from today's collect, because we are sorely hindered by our sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Please be seated. The reason we read the gospel here is because we've been sorely hindered by our sound system. And we're testing to see if maybe you could hear it if we read it from here. And you could. Okay, so maybe it is an antenna thing. Because we are sorely hindered by our sins is the way our collect begins on this third Sunday of Advent. Stir up thy power, O Lord, and with great might come among us. And because we are sorely hindered by our sins, let thy bountiful grace and mercy speedily help and deliver us. We begin this service and we pray. This third Sunday of Advent, we encounter John the Baptist yet again. We had the beginning of Mark's Gospel last week, which begins quite promptly and then goes straight to John the Baptist. This week, we have the beginning of John's Gospel, which begins with the prologue. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then, which we'll have on Christmas Day and on the first Sunday after Christmas. And then goes straight to John the Baptist. If it weren't for Luke's Gospel, we would have no Christmas. We'll have Luke on Christmas Eve. John was clearly important. In Greek, he's called the prodromos, the forerunner. He's the one who points to the one. He is the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way, and I cannot help but hear Gibbon's words, this is the record of John. Why don't we just do that today? Who's the countertenor? Okay, not today. Next year, next year. Prepare the way. Make straight the way of the Lord. The implication is that something's crooked. The human condition is that because we are sorely hindered by our sins, our way is crooked. Sometimes so crooked that we have no idea. And we need a guide to help us straighten it out. Sometimes we need John the Baptist. Now, I don't mean John the Baptist, that crazy, ragged prophet in the desert, though, if that's helpful, use it. I mean someone who can speak the truth to you in love, with an emphasis on love. Fifteen years ago, I was not as wise as I am today. I think that's probably true of all of us. I even had a temper. Yeah, I really did. I know, it's you can't imagine it. I used to get ticked off. And I like to get my way. None of you suffer from that. No. And I never get my way in my job. So when I'm on my own turf with my own friends, I expect things to be the way I want it. And one night I was not getting it. Some young Turk who had joined the organization a mere few months ago took the liberty of turning on a television set in a room where I thought no television set should exist. And I stood up and gave him so when I sat down with my friends who I knew would support me in my sorting out the young Turk, he wasn't actually Turkish, that's just a phrase. A friend turned to me and said, Ian, are you okay? And he didn't say it accusingly, he said it startlingly, tenderly. And I said, no, Jonathan, I don't think I am. And we walked off to another room and we talked for about an hour. And I shared with him and unburdened everything I'd been thinking, but not saying to anybody else in my life. Jonathan that night was John the Baptist for me. He pointed out that my way was crooked, and he helped me straighten it out. Maybe you need Jonathan the Baptist in your life. Maybe you can be John the Baptist in someone else's. The key here, if you're going to presume, and it is presumptuous to be John the Baptist in someone's life, is that it can't be by pointing a finger. It has to be with the outstretched arms of love. It has to be because you see in that person the brokenness which you feel in your own soul and you're trying to make it whole. It has to be because you are sorely hindered by your sins and you see that in another and you're trying to make that person whole. The fourth, last thing that we contemplate on this third Sunday of Advent is hell. Hell, classically defined, is the absence of God. And I can imagine nothing more lonely, than living a life of anger and bitterness and loneliness and isolation and having no one come up to me and ask me what's wrong and are you okay? Because it means no one cares enough about me to question me when I'm at my worst. We are called to be John the Baptist to each other. Why? Because we are sorely hindered by our sins, and we are called to be our brothers, our sisters, our mothers, our fathers, our friends, keepers, and they ours. And we are called to let them be ours, not to resist it, not to defend against it, but to embrace it in the spirit that it is intended, and to accept that even if it doesn't appear to be in the spirit, that God means it to be in that spirit, even if we can't see it. May we look for John the Baptist in others. May we be John the Baptist to each other. May we make straight what is crooked in our lives. And may we, in this last week, before we celebrate the Nativity of Christ,